It's Tuesday, March 14, 2017. I'm Albert Mohler, and this is The Briefing, a daily analysis of news and events from a Christian worldview. One of the major questions of the modern age is how religion can be made safe for a secular society. One of the defense mechanisms of secularism is to try to find some way to domesticate or to tame religious truth claims and also religious believers. Evidence of that comes in terms of how the mainstream media is a part of this process in the CNN series called Believer. It is moderated by Reza Aslan, and it is also getting headlines across the world in a way that CNN surely did not anticipate. For instance, coming from London, The Telegraph reports, quote, an American writer and presenter has come under fire for eating a human brain in his new TV documentary. In the first episode of CNN's new series Believer, presenter Reza Aslan met with the Agori, a nomadic religious sect based in India. The Agori worship the Hindu deity Shiva, but reject many of the tenets of Hinduism and practice a range of unusual ceremonies, including cannibalism. The Telegraph goes on to report, while staying with the Agori, Aslan drank alcohol from a human skull and ate a cooked piece of human brain. He later wrote on Facebook, "Want to know what a dead guy's brain tastes like? Charcoal. It was burnt to a crisp." End quote. Now here we simply have to pause for a moment and recognize that a fundamental question, long before we deal with the big worldview question, is this. What in the world was CNN thinking of? How can it possibly be justified that someone acting on behalf of the cable news network CNN could actually have participated in a ritual like this, much less have written about it and talked about it in public, much less done it for a video audience that CNN certainly must have hoped would have been counted in the millions? We are talking about a fundamental lapse in journalistic judgment. We're talking about one of the questions that must have media people scratching their heads all over the world. Again, what did CNN hope to accomplish by means of this broadcast? In terms of this new series, Believer, a major investment by CNN, one of the immediate questions comes back to this first episode and this act by which Reza Aslan, who had positioned himself as very much a cultural sophisticate, speaking of religion, was then found actually to have participated in this bizarre ritual that included, according to his own report, cannibalism. But then there's a second question, and that second question was immediately brought to mind by Hindu authorities worldwide, who responded in anger that this was being presented as mainstream Hinduism. Now again, according to this report, the Agori, the group covered in terms of this episode, worship a Hindu deity that is Shiva. We need to note that is a god of death. But we are told, even in this article, that they reject many of the tenets of Hinduism, and they practice a range of unusual ceremonies. Now, at this point, we will simply have to leave it to authorities on Hinduism to determine exactly how the Agori do and do not represent mainstream Hinduism. But the important thing to ask for our perspective is what in the world CNN was doing in presenting religious beliefs in this way. There is an agenda here. The agenda could be described as theological voyeurism. Reza Aslan was traveling around the world to find some of the most bizarre representations of religion he could find. And these are presented not only for shock value, but also in order to serve some larger worldview impulse. And for that, we really do not have to look very far. Pravithar Mothran, writing for the magazine Fast Company, suggests that what's really going on here in the CNN series Believer is that Reza Aslan is trying to immerse himself in the rituals and practices of various religious groups as a, quote, would-be salve for otherness, end quote. Now, that's a very interesting argument. It basically comes down to this. The argument that what Reza Aslan is trying to do here is to normalize all religion by pointing to the most bizarre examples he can imagine and then saying, we can really deal with this safely. There's no deep belief here we have to worry about. In a statement for Fast Company, Aslan said this, quote, for me, I've always wanted to be the person who helps people understand those who may not share their views or their ideas or their skin color or their religion. I want to be the interpreter of religion for people, the one who helps you break through the external shell of a particular religion to show you how familiar and similar it is to your own beliefs, whether or not you yourself are religious. I try to do this with my books, he said. I try to do this with my media commentary. And this TV show is basically another version of that. What I'm trying to do, he said, by introducing you to the religious group that may seem different and scary, is to show you that underneath it all, there is a connection that you have with these people, even if you don't believe it. So that's been my goal," end quote. Well, there's the agenda. It's an implausible agenda. In terms of religious belief, it should be an offensive agenda. But what he's saying here is that there really are no major differences among the religious worldviews of the world, even though there are different practices, and this may look strange to you. If you scratch below the surface, you will find out that all of these religions are basically the same. They hold to basically the same beliefs. They are driven by the same impulses. In an essay published at CNN, Aslan said this, quote, "Of course, as someone who has spent the better part of the last 2 decades studying the world's religions and having recently crisscrossed the globe for my new spiritual adventure series, Believer, where I immerse myself in religious traditions, both familiar and downright bizarre, I know better than to take the truth claims of any religion, including my own, too seriously," end quote. There's the quote we're looking for. Here is Aslan saying that he knows better than to take the truth claims of any religion, including his own, too seriously. His own, by the way, in terms of his identification, is Islam. More on that in just a moment. First, we need to note that this is exactly what we should expect as a secular society tries to find a way to look at the entire range of religious expressions in the world and say, number one, they do look strange. But number two, when you look more closely, they're all the same. You can go on beyond that and say, point three, they're really not as dangerous as you might think. But behind that is yet another agenda. When you look at Reza Aslan's view of religion, he sees it again as basically all the same. He says you don't look at the truth claims, rather you just look at the practices. And then if you do some kind of excavation of this religion, you'll discover that it's just like all the rest. His view to religious difference is trying to argue that there are no real differences. That's becoming increasingly difficult when you consider the range of the kinds of groups that Reza Aslan actually chose to portray in this program, starting with episode one. If that was his intention, I think we can say at this point, it was a spectacular failure. Just consider the headlines of the last 72 hours. No one is looking at the first episode of his program and saying, you know, he's right. Truth claims really don't matter. And these groups really do all believe the same thing. Remember what we're talking about in the first few words of the briefing today. Aslan's view of religion is functionalist and it's entirely pragmatic. He wrote, quote, "Faith is mysterious and ineffable. It's an emotional, not necessarily a rational experience. Religion," he said, "is a fairly recent human invention, but faith, as I have elsewhere argued, is embedded in our very evolution as human beings," end quote. So in Aslan's view, to be human is to be religious in the sense of this kind of basic faith impulse. And even though that impulse can be directed in many different ways and religious beliefs can take many different forms, in essence, it's just an evolutionary adaptation. It is simply a part of our evolutionary progress as human beings. Of course, there are those who take that argument and say, this is evidently one part of evolution we can well do without. One of the most famous figures in the modern world along those lines is Tufts University scientist Daniel Dennett, again back in the headlines with his latest book, who argues that religion, religious belief, faith, all of these must have been important in terms of the evolutionary development of human beings in some prior age. But he argues they're now just remnants of evolutionary artifacts that aren't needed anymore. We can outgrow religion, is Dennett's point. Aslan has indeed written several books on religion, and they're all fairly predictable. He wrote a book on Islam arguing that the modern jihadists are a corruption of Islam and that traditional Islam, as he says, is really not so much about beliefs but about practices, and once again, there should be no real threat from Islam to the world, modern or otherwise. He's written a book about Jesus Christ. The title of that book was Zealot. He argues that Jesus was basically a Jewish zealot who was misunderstood by his own disciples and wrongly claimed by the early church to be the very Son of God. He's written a book about conservative religion in the modern world, and this is very similar to the fundamentalism project of the larger academy. He argues that religious conservatives, regardless of whether they be Muslim, Hindu, Christian, or otherwise, are just trying to struggle to adapt to the modern world. But once again, religious truth claims are simply to be overcome or ignored or relativized. Again, I go back to that statement he made at Fast Company where he said, quote, "I want to be the interpreter of religion for the people, the one who helps you break through the external shell of a particular religion to show you how familiar and similar it is to your own beliefs." Well, just think again of this first episode. the viewers of this first episode would never have gained the impression that Reza Aslan says was his ambition. No one looking at that episode of CNN's Believer would come to say, you know, those people believe pretty much what I believe. As a matter of fact, even those who identify as mainstream Hindus are trying to say this was a misrepresentation of Hinduism. And they're arguing on the basis of truth claims and history. They're not arguing on the basis of some kind of hoped-for reality. Sometimes we find an argument becoming a parody of itself, and in this case, that's exactly what we see in this new CNN series. It's hard to imagine what CNN thought it was going to gain by this, perhaps some ratings, but the controversy is probably not what the network expected, but they certainly should have expected this. What in the world could they have expected when in the very first episode they present their own moderator of the program as engaged in cannibalism? Finally, on this issue, it's really interesting to understand how so many amongst the secular and creative elites, especially in the media, look at conservative Christians tied to Orthodox Christianity and say, look how strange that tribe is. But if CNN wants to see strange, all they have to do is watch their own monitors.